Madhouse. It's a name and a studio practically synonymous with quality shows. Since the studio's inception, the studio has put out a broad base of work of varying success. Shows like Death Note, Claymore, Trigun, the collective works of Satoshi Kon, and Pita-Ten. Yeah, Pita-Ten. Okay, maybe this won't be topping anyone's list of greatest hits by Madhouse. Yeah, it may be easy to forget. For all the high-end, mature shows put out by the studio, they certainly have had their share of cuter shows geared at younger audiences. Be it Cardcaptor Sakura, Digikarata, Galaxy Angel, and of course, this show. Pita-Ten is something of a special thing to me. It was one of the first manga I ever read when I was still fairly new to the medium of anime and manga. These days, I likely would have brushed off Pita-Ten as another typical harem show in a sea of so many already. Well, in 2004, ignorance was truly bliss. Eventually, I dropped off reading the manga just due to how difficult it became to find newer volumes in bookstores, and I picked up the anime sometime after that. Well after it was first produced and broadcasted, but long before it was licensed.
Now, I never would have imagined this show getting licensed over here in the United States. I mean, look at it! The cover screams, tastes like diabetes! Plus, if you've ever read the manga, you'll know it screams, tastes like diabetes. Especially in this era, with all the dark and gritty reboots, or the fan service laden shows, or just other moe shows in general, and light novel shows bringing up the charts, why would anyone want this silly little manga show from way back in the day? Especially with licensors whittling down to just a few companies, very few want to pick up older shows just because there's not much of a market for them. But wouldn't you know it, Nozomi came through.
Also, I need to give props for the advertising pitch. Being advertised for Madhouse, but still picking relevant shows to match it. I mean, it would have been easy and probably damn tempting to advertise it as the studio that made Death Note, Trigun, or those shitty Marvel anime. Hell, they could have advertised it as being from the writer of When They Cry, more commonly known as the Higurashi franchise.
I'm serious. Toshifumi Kawase, who directed the series, also handled the series composition scripts for the Higurashi franchise, as well as the anime series of Tsubasa Chronicle. Boy, what a turnaround, huh?
Our story is focused on one Kotarou Higuchi, a seemingly ordinary but solitary boy following the death of his mother, which just leaves him and his father. As such, his father is usually quite busy with work, leaving Kotarou alone most of the time. He meets a girl named Misha, a rather hyperactive teenager, and conveniently his next-door neighbor. Misha reveals herself to be an angel who has come down to Earth because she's a lousy angel up in heaven. Misha is a bubbly, perky, happy-go-lucky girl with a tendency to be quite clumsy, a need to shout rather than speak, and a desire to constantly cling to Kotarou, hence the title Pita-Ten, which literally translates as clinging angel. Well, seeing how lonely Kotarou is, she makes it her mission to help him, take care of him, and protect him, even if he never needs protecting at all. And what unfolds from there is episodic hijinks like most slice-of-life comedies, with various sitcom moments of the week. Kotarou's two best friends are Kobashi Uematsu and Takashi Ayanokoji, or simply referred to as Ten-chan. Takashi is a pretty boy character, he's beloved by the girls in his class, and he's a top-notch student. Kobashi is a childhood friend who has a crush on Kotarou and is a bit of a tomboy. And yes, she always wears those cat ears. Episode 4, we're introduced to a new character, Shia. Like Misha, Shia is also an apprentice demon under the guidance of her black cat mentor known as Nia-san. And like Misha, she of course is lousy at her job. Given she's a demon, she is supposed to bring about misfortune and calamity, but her kindness and meekness just gets in the way of that. Shia ends up becoming roommates with Misha and ends up befriending her quite nicely. And she ends up doing most of the cooking and cleaning for Misha, and a little bit of cooking for Kotarou as well. In episode 6, a rich spoiled kid named Hiroshi Matari is transferred in and he's instantly smitten with Misha. But he has a fierce, self-declared rivalry with Takashi. Well, a few episodes later, his younger sister, Kaoru, comes into the picture, and is instantly smitten with Takashi. In the manga, there's a recurring gag with Hiroshi being nicknamed Poops, Apparently, the character in his name is a pun of the Japanese word for bathroom, but this joke doesn't show up in the anime. Hiroshi, for all his faults, does have his moments where he gets to show some class as a character, such as one scene where he confides in Kotarou that he's simply wanting to live up to the greatness of his ancestors. Hiroshi can also sense Misha as a demon, and usually refers to her as a foul specter, and he constantly tries to exorcise her. Pita-Ten is saturated to the core in extreme adorableness. This show, in its respective manga, is perhaps the most sweet and diabetes-inducing series out there. Between Misha's overly adorable personality, Shia's absurd meek and sweetness, oh good god, it's sappy as hell, and I love every minute of it. Hard to say why. Everything about the show really should repel me away, but I guess it just has a sense of innocence and sweetness you don't get in a lot of comedy. I guess you probably couldn't call this a harem series either, because this is a pretty balanced male-to-female ratio cast. Also, there's a surprising lack of fan service for a show like this, where again, in most anime, some cute girl moves in next door. It's usually fan service guarantee. Frankly, it's nothing short of a miracle considering this show managed to have both a beach and a hot spring episode. In between the comedy, we do get some nice tender moments that make you stop and just go, aww, for just a moment. And then the hijinks will quickly return yet again. As I understand, the anime did end up overtaking the manga, so there are some episodes likely made entirely for the anime, but given Pita-Ten is already an episodic slice of life, you'll never know the difference without reading the manga anyway. I normally don't go to great lengths to point out the differences between manga and anime because it's not relevant, but given that this is a manga I have read, albeit only partly, I'll bring it up where it's relevant. Now, I can tell that even from the start that Pita-Ten does differ quite a bit from its source material, but it's not any worse off for it, although we do unfortunately miss out on some nice, serious moments from the manga, such as Kotarou's anxieties about getting into middle school, and just remembering fond moments with his late mother. While we do lose some good moments, we are deprived of others in return. Usually in the form of nice, warm, fuzzy moments, such as when Kotarou plays the Princess Kaguya for a school play, or an episode where Shia, Misha, and the others go to cheer up a bunch of children in the hospital, and so on. Another really good episode is when Kotarou's cousin, Shino, comes for a visit, while her father is away on a business trip. But that's just a cover story. Kotarou and company take Shino to an amusement park where she ends up overhearing that her father isn't away on business but is at the hospital. A panicked, grief-stricken Shino runs away, getting lost in the park, and just collapses crying. Everyone else splits up to find her, but Misha flies Kotarou high up in the sky to spot her, and eventually Shino is raced to the hospital by Misha to visit her father where, reassuringly, she finds out her father's going to be okay. Later, Misha's older sister, Sasha, descends to Earth to visit and check up on Misha. Once again, here's another difference between the anime and manga. In the manga, Sasha, of course, crushes on Takashi, but the anime omits this entirely. I can't complain about this change, seeing as Kaoru already has a strong crush on Takashi, and Takashi already likes Shia, so I think adding Sasha to the mix just makes it more bogged down than it needs to be. Sasha returns again in a later episode as Misha's angel exam proctor. Despite Misha's best efforts, she unfortunately fails her test. The last two episodes bring everything full circle. Shia is dismissed as a demon apprentice, and as a result, disappears forever. Because of Shia's disappearance, everyone but Misha forgets about Shia immediately, leaving Misha feeling alone and sad. Sasha tells Misha that she has now passed her angel exams, having erased Shia out of existence, but Misha just won't stand for this and works to find a way to restore Shia yet again. Kotarou slowly remembers Shia, but he's hesitant to go along with Misha's desires, knowing the pain it brings to remember loved ones lost. Sasha also explicitly tells Misha that she will be dismissed herself, and will also vanish if she tries to bring Shia back. Misha just doesn't let that stop her, and her work to restore everyone's memories brings Shia back, but sadly makes Misha herself fade from existence. But all is not lost, as 2 weeks later, Kotarou notices everyone remembers Misha, having previously forgotten her. and Misha makes a triumphant return to glomp Kotarou once more. The animation of Pita-Ten is rather all over the place, likely intentionally so. The art style feels a bit more cartoonish, for lack of better words, but the manga certainly had that same cartoonish style in and of itself. Characters bounce between chibi and normal, shots go on and off model intentionally, and so on, but seldom do we see the other typical off-model styles, such as faceless or stick figures or crayon drawings. There's some slight color palette changes from the characters' art in the manga, such as Misha's red hair being made more of a pure pink, but that usually comes with the transition of any medium. If there's a slight drawback to adapting the style of Koge-Donbo, is that Donbo tends to draw very large eyes. Yeah, I know, large eyes are very common in anime. While normally it doesn't bother me, the real problem is often the color in the eyes will darken in long shots, making their eyes just look like empty soul-piercing saucers of freakiness. Hikaru Nanisa provided the original score, and it's really good. Nanisa is a composer I need to start giving more credit to, because she's a very talented composer. Most Slice of Life OSTs are rather on the bland side, and while her score is of course bouncy and upbeat, par the course for a show like this, it has its moments of grandiose and can be rather soothing at times. It certainly makes for some nice listening for an anime like this, and the sound team and the director are not afraid to let it shine either. Even the eye catch is pretty memorable. As I mentioned, this series was licensed by Right Stuff International and Nozomi Entertainment, which unfortunately means no dub, not that I can blame them given the age and very limited demographic of the show. Probably for the best though, because I'm not sure I could listen to Hiroshi without hearing Mandark's voice as I did when I read the manga.
When I first picked up Pita-Ten, it was years ago. I was still new to the world of anime and manga, and I wasn't as familiar with the laden tropes that plague us all now. I didn't know what moe was, and probably many people else didn't know what moe was. But that doesn't matter. What matters was, it was the right manga at the right time. Now having watched the anime twice, being a little older and being a little wiser, I can see where the anime would appeal to some people strongly, but repel other people away at the same time. But to me, the sweetness and innocence of Pita-Ten is what so strongly appeals to me. It's that sweet and innocent charm that feels lost from a lot of modern shows that are either very slick or gritty, perhaps a little too much for their own good. It reminds me of a time gone by in anime when you could have genuinely cute and goofy and funny little shows like these without having to stoop to the lowest common denominator with comedy or excessive amounts of fan service. Pita-Ten knows what it wants to be, and it does what it wants to be. It's silly, and it's over the top. It's hyperactive, and it's over the top energy. But it still takes a moment to slow down and smell the flowers, much like a show like Fruits Basket, for example. And that's what I like about it. It reminds me of a show that I would have watched like Fruits Basket, so it reminds me truly of a time gone by. So for Pita-Ten, it's hard to say, but I love the show. It may not appeal to you, but I love it. I'm ShadowBlazer3000. Thanks for watching.